Hello, and welcome back to the sailing vessel Silverheels. One of the projects that I have planned for this winter here on Silverheels is a pretty substantial reworking of the galley area. And this is going to be a long and complicated project, and it's probably not going to be done until spring. But I've been working this fall, it's November now, to get to the point where I've achieved a proof of concept that it will fit into the space that's available. Because it's like everything else on a Rhodes 22, space is tight. So I thought I'd, while I have the mock-up up, I thought I'd start by showing you that so you have some picture in mind of what it is that I'm working towards here. So this is the mock-up, and about the only thing that I'm not changing much is the sink. We'll leave Stan's sink arrangement in place, and so we'll be able to reuse the countertop. So this big box here is the area for my new ice chest. Basically, I'm not really happy with the ice chest that's provided by General Boats, and so we're going to try to create something that's much more efficient in this space. So we'll have 2 inches of insulation on each side, so that'll take up a lot of the room. And based on my calculations, the space I should end up with inside should be a little bit bigger, but not a lot, than the space that's in the icebox provided by General Boats. So the big problem with this is to figure out how to get it in the boat and then the countertop on top of it. And I can't show you now. It just barely works, but it does work. So we have to get this all back out of the boat, and then we need to start actually doing some building. Time has passed. It's now December 5th, so a little under a month, and I have been working on the icebox project, and mostly what I've been working on is this. This is a mock-up of the lid. Now, it's not all a mock-up. This plywood is serving as a substitute for what will eventually be the countertop that came with the boat, but we did it up this way first. But all of the wooden components that I've created are the final components, so they'll be going into the final installation. And I'll go through this in more detail as we go through the steps of installing it into the final construction. The other thing I've been working on is the carcass, which much simpler job. I did that today. And so this is not the same one that was in the earlier segment, but it's the same dimensions. So the icebox goes up here, as I'm sure you recall, and there'll be some drawers that go down here. So while the work on the lid was complex and needed to be done with some degree of precision, it was just woodworking, which I had quite a bit of experience doing. But we're about to jump into realms of work where I really have no experience. So we're going to be working with foam insulation and epoxy resin and fiberglass to build the actual box. So we're in for an adventure, and you're along for the ride. And here is our foam insulation. The brand name on this is Tough R. I picked up this piece at Home Depot. Cost me $22 and some change. It's a 4x8 sheet, 1 inch thick. It's got an R value, an insulation value of 6.5 per inch of thickness, so it'll end up with a total
13. 25 years ago, when I was doing research in preparation for having this house built, I looked into all kinds of topics extensively, including foam insulation. And at that time, this material was the highest R value per inch of thickness of any commonly available insulating material. And here, 25 years later, and it still is. We have not improved this technology in 25 years, apparently. It's a little disappointing, but hopefully it will be good enough. The actual name for this material is polyisocyanurate, I think. I'm pronouncing that correctly. So our first challenge is going to be how to cut this up.
I've got a computer program where if you feed in the dimensions of all of the pieces you need to cut, and the dimensions of your base stock, 4 by 8 feet in this case, it'll figure out how to lay the cuts out so that you maximize the efficiency of the process, which is what we've got here. Now, I don't think I'm going to do most of my cuts with a table saw. I'm just afraid it's going to make some really nasty dust. But to start with, we need to make this full-length 8-foot cut. And I'm going to at least start and do that cut on the table saw.
So I read in at least one place a recommendation not to use your standard woodworking tools to cut this foam insulation because of the issue of dust. But perhaps that person didn't have the benefit of a dust collection system like I do. That seemed to go just fine. And so in the interest of accuracy, I'm going to continue to use the table saw to cut out my foam panels. Our pieces have all been cut out, and I've done an initial test assembly, all dry fit, and we can take a look at that.
So here's the the basic box, the four sides and the bottom. The inside dimensions of this are pretty close to exactly 12 inches top to bottom, deep, 15 and a half inches left to right from our current perspective, and 26 and a half inches end to end. And here's the insulation for the top of the icebox. The icebox lid is going to be right at the front edge, so that's why there's no insulation here on this side. So we've got insulation on the three other sides, 2 inches thick, and this is where actually having the 1-inch thick material made life easier than it would have been if I had 2-inch thick, which is what I had been looking for initially. And here's really the benefit of cutting everything out on the table saws. I could be really precise with the size of things, and so that's going to fit pretty much perfectly there. And this is everything that's left over from that 4x8 sheet. So, not a lot of waste, which was not due to excellent planning on my part. More serendipity.
So now we need to glue pieces together to create the 2-inch thick walls. And I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do that. I'm pretty sure I'm not going to use epoxy resin just to attach one piece of foam to another piece of foam, but I'll have to play around some and see what works well, so it's a good thing I have at least some scraps to work with. So my first guess as to an appropriate glue for this turned out to be appropriate. What this is, it's a fast acting adhesive, but it's not instantaneous. So you got a few seconds of work time, which is going to be important because I need to line pieces up before the glue sets. But it will adhere within 15 seconds or so. So I don't have to clamp it and sit around and wait for it overnight or anything. So I can move right along. So the name for this stuff is cyanoacrylate. And actually, I got it for woodworking projects. It came from Rockler, which is a store which caters to woodworkers, rockler.com. And it comes in two parts. So there's a something they call stick fast. And then there's an activator that you put on the opposite surface. So I don't think this is actually going to make a lot of difference, but this insulation comes with a shiny side. I hope I didn't get your eyes. And a less shiny side. And I want the shiny side out to reflect heat away. I think in order for that really to be effective, there needs to be an air gap, and there's not going to be one. So, but it doesn't do any harm. So I'm not going to spread it over the whole surface. I'll do some in the corners. And what the directions say is to put the glue on one side and the activator on the other. And this is a spray bottle, but the sprayer is broken. So I'm going to use an alternate method. And they say this stuff should be used sparingly. Come on. There. And now, pressure for a few seconds. I won't make you watch. So, a few seconds later, and there's one of our end panels. I'm not going to really test this bond. It doesn't really need to be that strong, and I suspect it's really not. But it's strong enough that I can treat this as one piece now. So I'll continue on and do that with the other panels that make up the box. We interrupt this glue up session to bring you a step that I forgot, fortunately in time. The main box, I want to have a divider in it to help keep things organized, and it'll just be a piece of plywood running, port to starboard. But I want to put a slot in the two inner insulation pieces to support the ends of that divider. We need to do that, or it's much easier to do it before we've glued the inner and outer pieces together. So we'll do it now. Well, it's late in the day, and I've just made the first mistake that I'm aware of anyway. So I put lines on the two inside pieces and to guide me in cutting the slots that will support the divider, and in one of the cases I cut on the wrong side of the line. So then, of course, I had to make another cut, which means now in this piece I have a 1-inch wide slot instead of a 1/2-inch wide slot. So this is fixable. So at some point I'll have to fill in the void with some scrap foam, and then the resin and fiberglass will cover it all up, and no one will ever know except you. So after I screwed up the slots for the divider yesterday, I quit for the day. But I came back this morning and completed gluing up the panels. So for instance, now this top component can be treated as one piece. Now the glue I chose to use, which I described, was good enough, but wasn't great. I don't think there's a really a lot of holding power And I had to redo a couple more than once to get them to stick together. But I think it's going to be good enough for this purpose. Our next step is to cut out plywood pieces, quarter inch thick, to cover the bottom and sides of our box. The foam itself is pretty fragile, and the plywood will provide some protection for that. So I should mention that a guide I'm using on this project is an article I found on the web entitled Building an Efficient Icebox. So I'm pretty sure you could find it if you search for that title. I'm pretty sure it's written by someone who works for the West Systems company, and it features West System products, epoxy and fillers, so forth. It actually, the icebox that they build there is a standalone icebox, more like a cooler chest. So there's lots of stuff that it wasn't helpful on, but the main points of construction of the box itself, it was very useful. So we'll get started on that. So here's our box with the plywood sides and bottom installed, and we've got some springy sticks holding the sides firmly out against the foam. Our next step involves attaching the side pieces to the foam and to each other. I want to avoid, at this point in the project, attaching in any way the side components to the bottom components. So we're going to try very hard to avoid doing that. Our material of choice for doing this work is going to be epoxy resin, and we'll talk about that for a second. As I mentioned, that article I found online with instructions of how to build an efficient icebox was, I'm pretty sure, written by someone who works for West Systems. And so naturally it features West System products quite prominently. And I thought I was going to too, but when I went out to look for actual West Systems supplies, I ran across Jamestown Distributors in Jamestown, Rhode Island, .com, whatever. And they have a product that they say is compatible with the West Systems systems, but was a little cheaper. So I just decided I'd try that. So this is resin and slow primer, slow hardener. They haven't duplicated the entire West Systems catalog, so we have West Systems 407 low density filler. We'll be using that for making fillets in the corners. And we've got some white pigment from West Systems, so we can make the inside of our icebox nice and bright white. We've also got a spreader notched on three sides and smooth on the fourth, and a stirring stick, which also has a curved end, which is again useful for making those fillets. So we mixed up a small batch of unthickened epoxy, three squirts each of the resin and hardener, and we're going to put some on the back sides of the two end pieces. I'm not going to bother to cover the entire back side. I don't see much point in that. Not much to this. Oops. It's pretty thick stuff. So I've done something similar here with the side pieces. The side pieces fit between the end pieces, so I've made sure I put some epoxy on the ends of the sides, so they should get good adhesion. There is my first attempt at filleting. I'm not sure that's coming out, but we'll have to see what that looks like in the morning. So our initial application of epoxy resin, both unthickened and thickened, has dried overnight. And so now it's time to see if we can separate the four sides from the bottom and remove the whole thing from the carcass. Well, the box did come out of the carcass and the bottom did come off. The reason I wanted to do that was so that I could easily get to the underside of the top, and I can coat the top with resin and make a fillet around the corners. Unfortunately, you know, some of that glue work of gluing panels together didn't hold up, so we'll have to revisit that. So I've decided to address my glue-up problems first, and what I used was some Gorilla Glue, because I had that around. I've never used this before, and I've had this for quite a while. I bought it, you know, just in case. And it says to spread it thinly, but this goop is pretty thick, and I don't know if it's supposed to be that thick, so this is kind of a crapshoot. It says it's water activated, so we sprayed some water on the surfaces before attempting to bond them. So we're holding, so it was the top panel and the bottom panel that were coming apart, so we can just apply some weight and that'll force both sides together. So we have to wait an hour or two, it says. Kind of indistinct. But we'll wait an hour and hopefully we can get some more work done today. It's an hour later and the Gorilla Glue seems to be doing its job. And thinking back on this whole glue-up process, probably the proper approach to take would be to have some fast hardener for the epoxy resin, and that way you could glue it up with something you're pretty sure is going to hold. And it's going to behave correctly and will cure in less than 12 hours. So on to the next step, which is again to attach the top piece to this, and then we'll work on the seams between the top and the sides through the bottom. So I put some unthickened epoxy on the meeting surfaces between the sides of the box and the top. I didn't use a lot. There's not going to be a lot of forces trying to pull these things apart, and I certainly didn't want to have to deal with squeeze out or anything. So now we can put the top in place. And turn the whole thing over. And now we can work on the joints between the sides and the top. So we'll thicken up some epoxy and make a fillet around the three sides. So here's what the fillet around the top looks like. I tried to be reasonably careful with this, even though once the cooler is fully assembled, it's going to be literally impossible to see the underside of the top unless you use a mirror. So we'll have to let that cure. Obviously, we can't do any cleanup by sanding the foam parts where the plywood is. We can sand that. But the next step will be to start applying unthickened epoxy to the foam surface itself. Hopefully that'll stick. While we're waiting for some epoxy to dry, we'll move on to talk about the lid for the icebox. This plywood you see here is just here temporarily to help with the mock-up and proof of concept for the lid. Actually, part of the trim that we trim out of the countertop will eventually become the surface of the lid when we're done. So underneath the lid, we have three frames that work together to support it. The innermost frame is what the lid sits directly on. This weather stripping around the edge will sit on that piece. And both of these, that edge and this piece, are beveled at 15 degrees because I thought that any spills or whatnot would be easier to clean up that way. But that will not be attached directly to the countertop. It'll be attached to the next piece out. This piece will go through the countertop, and the top edge of this will be visible when the installation is complete. So it'll be like a trim piece. But this also will not be secured directly to the countertop. It'll be secured to the outermost piece, which will be screwed up into the underside of the countertop. As I mentioned way back at the beginning, we're going to at least attempt to reuse the existing countertop, the one that came with the boat. So we need to first figure out how to position this piece pretty accurately on the underside of the countertop, and then then it's a pretty simple matter to just screw it in place.
We've removed the support shelf from the carcass for the icebox, and so we could access the icebox from underneath. And we've got that carcass upside down on the bottom side of the countertop. And when we had the mock-up in the boat during the opening shots of this video, I made some pencil marks on the underside of the countertop, which allows me to put it back in the same position, which I know is the correct position. So we put the icebox back into the carcass, obviously, and we've got the two outer frames resting, well, really on top of the icebox, but since the icebox is upside down, they're now underneath it. And as you can see, the inner of those two frames lines up pretty exactly with the opening in the foam in the countertop, which is the way it's supposed to be. So now I can just go ahead and use a pencil and outline the position of the inside of this middle frame, and then that'll allow me to position the outer frame when the icebox is removed, and we can go ahead and attach it.
Put a total of 14 screws through pre-drilled holes into the underside of the countertop, and that might seem like a lot of screws, but the countertop is only half an inch thick, so there's not a lot of material to work with there, so hopefully that will be sufficient. I also should point out here, as kind of a design principle, Stan, when he put together the cabin, mostly used screws to put stuff together, and I'm going to try to stick with that as a philosophy, so that things can come apart again if they need to for some change. So I didn't use any glue here, and for the most part, I'm not going to glue anything permanently into the boat. Moving back to the box, our next step is going to be to apply 3-inch wide fiberglass tape to the four corners. Later on, there'll also be fiberglass tape on the joints between the sides and the bottom, but can't do that until we have the bottom in place. but I think it's going to be easier to do these corners now. This morning, I took advantage of some nice weather to take the countertop, the ice chest, and the carcass for the ice chest, and take them all out to the boat and do a test installation to make sure that this frame we attached is in the proper location, because I'm about to use it as a guide to make the big hole in the countertop that will eventually become the opening for the ice chest. And I'm happy to say that it is in the right place. So we took everything back off the boat. Moving back to the icebox itself, the fiberglass tape cured overnight, and I spent some time this afternoon sanding the edges of that, feathering them out to make them smooth so there's not an obvious seam there. And having done that, we're now ready to apply our first coat of resin to the underside of the top of the ice chest and to the four walls. Now we're going to use a roller for the most part to do that. We'll need brushes and get into the corners, of course. And as I think I mentioned earlier, we're going to use some white pigment in that epoxy to make the inside of our ice chest a nice bright white. Clearly, this is going to take several coats, which is what I expected. So I'm guessing three or four. To do the inside of the box, I mixed up 4 ounces of epoxy, resin, and that turned out to be just about perfect. So we'll do that again for the next coat tomorrow. The time has come to make the cutout for the icebox lid. So, again, using the frame piece that's mounted on the underside as a guide, I drilled holes close to the four corners, not quite tight up against them. And then here on the front side, I've masked off the area where the cut is going to be done with masking tape to hopefully reduce the likelihood of getting any chip out in the laminate. And connected the four holes with lines, and we'll use our jigsaw to go ahead and cut that out. Well, now we have a big hole in our countertop. The approach I'm going to take, one of the benefits of it is that that cut didn't need to be very accurate, which is a good thing because it's not. And we did get a little bit of chip out, but I'm pretty sure that that will all get trimmed off. So the next step is we're going to take our router with a flush trimming bit with the bearing on the bottom. And again, we're going to use the frame piece that's mounted to the underside as a guide and trim the countertop back to be flush with that frame. Well, now that we've trimmed the opening to be flush with the outermost frame piece, we can install the next inner frame piece. The flush trimming bit left round corners, and we accommodated that by putting round corners on our frame piece here. This piece will get attached to the outer frame with screws, and I've provided elongated holes for screws and for countersinks. That'll provide for some adjustability so that we can make the top of the frame completely flush with the top of the countertop laminate. So there's our middle frame installed with just a few of the 10 screws that in the final installation will hold it in place. So now the innermost frame piece can be installed into the middle frame piece. And as with that piece, this will get screwed to its neighbor through elongated holes with elongated recesses for adjustability. And the recesses also will make it so the screw heads don't protrude into the opening. So there is the opening for our ice chest. The dimensions on this are 20.5 by 7.5. So we've taken the piece that we cut out of the middle, and out of that cut out our two doors and surface mounted the hinges temporarily just to test the fit, which is pretty good. Actually, I got a little bit ahead of myself doing this. I need to bevel the edges to match the 15 degree bevel of the innermost frame piece. So I'm going to create that bevel on our Icebox doors with the shaper, since I have a shaper and the appropriate shaper tooling. You could do this, I suppose, on a router table or a table saw. You'd need some kind of jig or at least a tall fence. The only tricky part about this is that I have to remember to only do the bevel on three sides and not the side where the hinge goes. The next step in the process is to create recesses to accept the hinges on our lid doors. These, of course, need to be made with some degree of precision. So once again, we've made a jig to help us with that, and we'll use our router with a bit with a guide bearing on the top this time. In addition to hinges, we also have flush-mounted pulls to install. And we're going to use the same templates that we used for the cabin floor to make the various recesses needed here in the Icebox doors. Our doors now have their full complement of recessed flush-mounted hardware, hinges and pulls. So now we can turn the doors over and we need to attach one of these pieces to each door. And I don't have a clever name for this. Its purpose is to hold and protect the 2 inches of foam insulation that'll be behind each door. And we don't want to attach that by screwing through the door. So this is our mock-up piece, and we mounted two cleats to the bottom of that and then our protector piece to the cleats, and we'll take the same approach. And our final piece, we'll just move these cleats over. two features of this I want to point out while I have it close at hand. One is that this piece that goes towards the outer edge is tapered, and that's about a 9-degree angle. And that's so this lower edge will clear the inner frame when the hinge is rotated up, or when the door is rotated up. And I'll show you that again when it's fully assembled. The other thing is we've got a channel here that will accept some of the weather stripping we're going to use. And there's a matching piece on the other unit. And that's to prevent drafts down through the center crack in the door. We're nearing the end of our work on the doors for the icebox, and it's time to apply insulation. So I went down and visited my local Home Depot and reviewed what was available in their weather stripping department, and I chose this product, EPDM D Profile Self-Stick Weather Seal. It's actually a double D profile. You can separate these two, which is shown in the picture, but I'm going to leave them attached to each other. It's 1/4 inch thick. Each individual D profile is 5/16 of an inch wide, so together they're about 5/8. And we've allowed for 3/4 inch for the surface that's where this is going to be applied. So we should be good there. So there's a variety of ways you can cut this. I've already started here. Scissors work okay if you cut it before you install it, or a utility knife will work okay. It'll tear a little bit if you want to cut it after it's installed. So there's our weather stripping installed. It's on all four sides, of course, and there's also two pieces between the lids to prevent those drafts down the middle. I did okay at the corners, but anytime I have to cut something freehand as opposed to using expensive woodworking machinery, it comes out less well. So the weather stripping could have gone either here on the lid, or it could have gone in the tapered angled piece in the opening, and it might be a little more thermally efficient there because you don't have the break in the middle for the hinge. But I decided putting it here would be less likely to produce issues related to having to clean up spills and that kind of thing. So that's the way we went with that. And so here is our nearly completed door and frame assembly. I'm going to put some polyurethane on all the wood pieces, which means some things will have to come back apart again, but that's okay. It's a long time until spring. And underneath, hopefully you can see how beveling the end piece on the underside allows it to just clear the support frame. So I haven't been making video of me painting on successive coats of tinted epoxy primer onto the inside of the ice chest, because that's pretty boring, but here we have the results of 3 coats, and it's coming along, but it definitely will need a few more coats. So the oak pieces in our frame and lid for the icebox have received 5 or 6 coats of polyurethane, which makes it a little shiny and should help protect it. And having done that, we've installed 2 inches of foam into the undersides of the lids, and the exposed surface of the foam has been treated with 6 coats of tinted epoxy resin, which should help protect that and makes it look nicer. At this point, the underside of the top of the icebox and the 4 sides have all received 6 coats of epoxy resin as well. And it's time to start thinking about putting the bottom on the icebox. And in thinking about that, it occurred to me that I have one additional task to do before the bottom goes on, which is to drill a hole in the side of the icebox to accommodate some pipe for a drain. And you may be wondering why the drain is going to be in the side and not the bottom. And the reason is the drain tubing is going to run to the existing through hull that serves the sink drain. And that through hull is only a little bit lower than the bottom of the icebox will be. And so if I went through the bottom, it would drop down too low. It won't work that way. So that's why we're going through the side. Now, of course, we want to be able to drain the icebox, but we also want it to not drain when that's appropriate. So we need some kind of plug for that. The tubing run is going to be accessible, inaccessible in the galley furniture. So the place where we have to be able to stop the draining is at the icebox itself on the inside. So we need a plug to go on the inside of the icebox. And initially I was thinking I would use something like this, but I find that this requires more force than I'm afraid that this will be able to tolerate. So we needed something that would work a little more easily than that, and we came up with this. This is a 1-inch pipe thread plug, and I couldn't find this exact configuration in plastic, so I did find one in aluminum in the McMaster Car catalog, so that's what we're going to use, despite the fact that aluminum is an excellent conductor of heat. So then we need a fitting that has the female 1-inch pipe thread. And I had what I actually want is one that's a coupler, so it has a female thread on both ends. I had a hard time finding one, but I did eventually find one, and it's in the mail now. So I then thought it would be nice if we could recess this so it didn't stick into the body of the icebox. And to accommodate that, this is a coupler for 1 1/4-inch pipe. And I've removed the ridge from the middle of that. And the 1-inch coupler will fit rather snugly inside the 1 1/4-inch coupler. And a little epoxy will seat that, I think, quite well. When we get to that point. So we need a hole through the side of the ice chest to accommodate this coupler, which is just a little under 2-inch outside diameter, which is nice, because that means it will fit rather firmly in a 2-inch hole. And to make that hole, we're going to use a hole saw. Through some experimentation, I have found that this will do a decent job of cutting through the foam, whereas a Fosner bit will not. It has a tendency to wander about. So we'll use this to cut the hole. The reason this hole had to be done before putting the bottom on is that the hole is actually going to be cut so that the bottom of the pipe will be a little bit below the bottom of the icebox, so it'll drain completely. And also to accommodate that, we cut a notch in the plywood that'll go on the bottom, and that will make a little depression here in this corner, which hopefully will also help us drain the icebox completely when we want to. Thank you.
So that went okay. One of the things I did to improve my odds of a successful outcome there was to clamp this sacrificial piece of quarter-inch plywood to the outside, and that helps to guide the hole saw as it cuts through the foam. So that's what our drain looks like in place. It's just there temporarily now, but once we put the bottom on, we're never going to get an opportunity to see it this clearly again. We've used a wood rasp to remove just a little bit of material here to accommodate the bottom of the outer pipe. Like that. So the glue has failed for the outer piece of the front panel again. So we've lost that temporarily. It's not an issue really. Our first step in putting the bottom in is to put the divider in, which actually, having lost the front panel, makes it a little easier, and it'll make the next step easier too. We now have to fill this gap that was due to our error earlier, and we can plug the slot that the panel was slid through. I've cut and inserted our foam patch pieces. They're just friction fit, which will be good enough. And our next step is to put in the plywood pieces for our bottom, which, as with the sides, serve to protect the foam. On top of that, of course, goes the bottom foam panel, but I want to actually glue the plywood to the foam, and so I'll mix up some epoxy resin and put a few dollops on here. I won't coat the whole thing. And then go ahead and insert the foam. There's the inside of our icebox. So the next step is to thicken up some of that epoxy resin and create fillets around all of the edges of the bottom. Our thickened epoxy cured overnight, and now we need to spend some time sanding to smooth things out. The sanding of the thickened epoxy on all the seams around the bottom has been completed, so that's all pretty smooth now, and we're ready to move on to our next step, which is going to be to apply some fiberglass cloth to further add more protection and to further strengthen the box. The article that I found online about how to build an icebox recommended using fiberglass tape to go around all the seams in the bottom, and then come back and put the fiberglass cloth just on the bottom. But I think I'm going to take a different approach that will kill two birds with one stone. I'll cut the cloth a little oversized so it can lap up the sides, and I think that will work just as well and save us a step. One other thing that I did, this is something that occurred to me in the middle of the night. We're going to need a hole in our carcass for the drain pipe, and that hole has to obviously line up with the hole in the ice chest. I puzzled about how to make sure that happened for a bit, and then brought out my hole saw again, and the way the hole is configured, I can't insert the hole saw into the hole from inside the ice chest, but I can insert it from outside and then put the ice chest into the carcass and then attach my screw gun to it and turn it just enough to mark the location of the center of the hole. Here are our pieces of fiberglass cut out. I'm only going to have the fiberglass go up the sides for the outsides of the box, not up the central divider. So the only place I've got to deal with three-sided corners are at the outside corners
of the box, and so I've cut out squares of material there, so hopefully I'll avoid folds there. And I cut out some additional material here where the drain is going to be to avoid blocking the drain.
The fiberglass has been successfully installed into the bottom of the icebox. This was a little trickier than I anticipated to get it properly positioned and all the bubbles out and deal with all of the unraveling strings at the edges. But I think it's okay, and as always, it will have to sit overnight. The fiberglass in the bottom of the ice chest has cured overnight, and I spent some time this morning sanding it out, and now it's time to start applying once again our white tinted unthickened epoxy to the bottom and the divider and up the sides as far as I can work. So I imagine this will take the same 6 coats that the top did.
So at this point we've put about 3 coats of tinted epoxy primer on the bottom and lower sides of the icebox. We're going to take a break from that exciting work to revisit our drain for the icebox. The special part that I had ordered has come in. I had a hard time finding this. What this is a coupler that has a 1-inch pipe thread on both ends. I did eventually find it at pvcfittingsonline.com. And the reason I wanted this is I want to put our threaded plug in one end and this fitting in the other end, which is an adapter with 1-inch pipe thread on one end and a barbed fitting for 1-inch ID flexible tubing on the other end. So, and if, as you recall, I want to have this recessed in the wall of the icebox, and we're going to accomplish that by inserting it into this larger coupling fitting. But in order for that to work, I'll have to remove this octagonal structure from the center that's there, presumably so you can put a wrench on it. But the insertion won't work with that in place. So wood rasp made quick work of removing the octagonal section from the middle of our coupler. So it will now fit inside the outer coupler, and we've made up some thickened epoxy, and what we're going to do is we'll insert our plug just hand tight. We'll put some epoxy on this and we'll insert it like this, and that will guarantee that the plug is exactly flush. With the epoxy holding together our plumbing pieces here, having cured overnight, we can now make up some more thickened epoxy and insert the pieces into the hole in the icebox. After we epoxied our plumbing pieces for the drain into the wall of the icebox, we continued to apply coats of tinted epoxy to the bottom and sides of the icebox. I lost track of how many coats I did, enough so that I got tired of doing it and called it quits. I didn't achieve perfect pure whiteness. A little bit of the underlying color shows through, but any additional coats would be purely cosmetic, and I stopped doing it. Putting those final coats of epoxy resin on the inside of the icebox was really the last step of the icebox project itself. After that, I did do some furniture making to create this face frame for the carcass, and I built a couple of drawers that'll live underneath that still need stain on the outside. And since I had the countertop and counter base for the from the galley out of the boat already, I was able to kind of do this mock installation to see how it all looked together. Real installation is going to have to wait till we get a break in the weather sometime in the spring. We're getting 3 to 8 inches of snow outside this afternoon. Today is January 7th. So when that day does come, that will be included in a video, and that'll be, I hope, one of several videos I plan to do in the spring concerning a variety of projects on SB Silver Eels. So thanks for watching, and see you again soon, I hope.